Welcome, everyone. My name is Julia Bird. I'm the vice chair here at the Center for Latin American Studies at UC Berkeley. I'm so happy to be with you all today to host this great event. We have the honor of participating in a conversation today with Professor Charles Briggs, Professor Patricia Baquedano Lopez, and Bernardo Moreno about Professor Briggs's recent book, Unlearning, Rethinking Poetics, Pandemics, and the Politics of Knowledge. Today's event is the third event in a series we initiated this academic year called Novedades, Lançamentos, which highlights new scholarship at Berkeley. In this series, we discuss new work from Berkeley scholars on Latin American and the Caribbean. And before we move ahead, I want to give a quick plug to the next and last event in the series, which will be with Professor Estel Tirica about her upcoming book, Holocaust Consciousness and Cold War Violence. She'll be in conversation with Professor Robert Kaufman and Alejandra Decker. And that's going to be on April 7th. So we'll see you back here then. And I have a couple of housekeeping notes for you. First of all, we'll be using the Zoom Q&A feature. So if you look down below, you should see a little bubble with Q&A on it. And if you have questions, feel free to write them in throughout the event and we will take a look at them and hopefully get to as many as possible. And we will record, this is being recorded, and we'll share the recording in our newsletter and on our website. So you can subscribe to the newsletter in the link that will be kindly put into the little chat. And it should be up in about a week. All right, and now on to our event. I'm so pleased to be here to open the conversation with Professor Charles Briggs, Professor Patricia Baquedano Lopez, and Bernardo Moreno on Charles's new book. And before I hand it over to them, I'm going to talk for a minute more and give you and do some introductions. So Charles Briggs is the Allen Dundas Distinguished Professor of Folklore in the Department of Anthropology at UC Berkeley. He's also the chair of the Folklore Graduate Program, the co-director of the Medical Anthropology Program, and the co-director of the Berkeley Center for Social Medicine. I have social media in my mind. He's the author of numerous books and has received honors as like the James Mooney Award, the Chicago Folklore Prize, the Edward Sapir Book Prize, the Americo Paredes Prize, the New Millennium Book Award, and the Cultural Horizons Prize. His latest work is titled Unlearning, Rethinking Poetics, Pandemics, and the Politics of Knowledge. It brings together colonialism, health, media, psychoanalysis to rethink classic work on poetics and performance, and that revolutionized linguistic anthropology. Also revolutionized fields of folkloristics, media studies, communication, and others. He will be in conversation with Patricia Baquedano Lopez, who's an associate professor in the Graduate School of Education. She's a linguistic anthropologist of education who investigates the relationship between migration, academic development, and educational policy. She's affiliated faculty in the Department of Anthropology and is a co-founding and core member, faculty member of the Designated Emphasis in Indigenous Language Revitalization at UC Berkeley. And they will be in conversation with Bernardo Moreno Peniche, who is a PhD candidate in the UC Berkeley and UCSF Joint Medical Anthropology Program. And he has a designated emphasis in science and technology studies. He researches the occurrence of Chagas disease in the US and how it gains relevance through nation-building discourses and practices that redraw racial and species boundaries. So I think that is enough from me. I'm going to hand it over to our speakers now. And we'll start with Professor Briggs. Thank you.
Well, thanks for the introduction. Thanks very much to the Center for Latin American Studies, especially Director Natalia Brizuela, Vice Director Julia Bird, Janet Wagaman, who did all the hard work of making this event possible, and particularly to Professor Patricia Baquedano Lopez and Dr. Bernardo Moreno Peniche for the gift of reading the book and offering their reflections on it. Now, I want to begin with a confession and a story. So the confession is, I actually really like writing books. And the story is, I began my first book when I was a college sophomore. And if you'll get the slides up there somewhere, if that's possible. So since you're looking at the way I look now on Zoom, I thought we might, on the next slide, you might see that if you could maybe move along to the next. I was young once. Actually, I was in my 30s here in this particular story, in this particular picture. But writing a book was not my idea. I was hanging out in with Latinx woodcarvers, maybe next slide, in Cordoba and my home state of New Mexico. Now, with the woodcarvers, people had written a lot about them, but nobody had written with them. And maybe move to the next. The carvers wanted a book that did not depict them as remnants of an outdated world, but placed their work in the context of racism and land, labor, and cultural expropriation. Maybe next slide. After writing a first draft, I began graduate school. So I was called in to discuss the topic for a graduate seminar paper. I proposed writing about New Mexico. The professor responded, "You couldn't possibly have enough data. Write about Polynesia." So I wrote a term paper about Polynesia. And while I was there without telling anybody, because they weren't really interested, and because my commitment was really to the people of Cordoba, New Mexico, right? I wrote a book manuscript. And I guess you might move to the next one. And somehow I turned it in for the James Mooney Award competition and seemed to have won. Now, what I didn't realize then, I was still in graduate school, was that my collaborators had shaped a template for all of my writing projects right through the present, as being fundamentally community-driven, where my interlocutors suggested what focus would be the most valuable, being decolonial and anti-racist at the center, and being based on research that was more apprenticeship and dialogue rather than processes of extraction. So you might go to the next slide. Now, I would not have been able to tell you this 4 years ago, because this observation emerged from a process of taking stock that I began at that time. Now, I'll tell you, I've never really been very comfortable with academic conventions. I was told that being a scholar means sticking to a particular disciplinary convention. A friend of mine once remarked, "I'm like a crab in a seawall cave. You stick your finger in and I will bite it." Well, I run up against this imperative almost every time, not today, that I'm invited to present a lecture. Dr. Briggs has researched a broad array of topics. Okay, true enough. I'm a card-carrying linguistic anthropologist and medical anthropologist, and I've chaired programs in folklore, ethnic studies, Latin American studies, and performance studies. And I'm also really into theory and psychoanalysis. So 4 years ago, I revoiced this criticism myself and said, "What's up? Why do you move around so much?" And maybe two insights emerged. First, I've always been fascinated by, but also uncomfortable with, the disciplining of knowledge. Thus, I try to dig deeply enough into each discipline on which I draw in order to discern its infrastructure, the premises and practices of knowledge production that get taken for granted and that simultaneously label other things non-knowledge and place them off limits and impose boundaries that keep other people out. Most of this just simply gets taken for granted. Now, that's why I like moving between fields. My procedure is to take a research object, right, and then use different disciplinary or subdisciplinary lenses, kind of like a kaleidoscope, gaining new insights on the phenomenon, right, and shaking up disciplinary infrastructures in the process. All right, so that brought me to another question. So why are you so undisciplined? Why so uncomfortable with disciplinary constraints? And it finally dawned on me that this penchant was also not of my own creation, but actually sprung up from conversations with mentors, people like woodcarvers, healers, lamenters, and myth performers who drew on sophisticated practices of knowledge production and were interested in philosophically thinking about their premises in ways that challenged academic disciplined perspectives. Now, the Latin American context of much of my research is crucial. I traveled through Venezuela to see where I might conduct research that could be useful. Next slide, please. In the swamplands at the mouth of the Orinoco River, an indigenous social movement, we might move to the next slide if that's possible, was forming. And so people thought that work on Warao, the indigenous language, might be valuable in pushing for bilingual education programs and more adequate health services. We might go to the next slide. Learning Warao, I asked people to teach me what they considered most important. Maybe move to the next slide. Here is Tirso Gomez, the late Tirso Gomez, a healer, a myth teller, and one of my mentors. I recorded hours of myths, legends, laments, healing songs, and discourses that challenged anti-Indigenous racism, as well as, I might say, you know, interactions between medical practitioners and their patients as well. Now, one problem with the highly US-centric framework of poetics and performance that I actually helped develop is that scholars would make recordings and then take them home, positioning themselves as the privileged interpreters. I rather sat with people for months or sometimes years, participating in conversations that brought together competing perspectives, often including across the lines of gender, about how these performances shape past and presence and hopefully less oppressive futures. Next slide, please. I also spent a lot of time with Latin American intellectuals. Years of collaboration with Jaime Brail and other scholars of Latin American social medicine and critical epidemiology challenged the Eurocentric underpinnings of my work in medical anthropology. And friends assigned me, along with Dr. Clara Montini Briggs, the soul-wrenching job of researching how hundreds of deaths were the result of racist policies as much as cholera and rabies pathogens. So next slide, please. And we can just stay here. No, you can just leave it there. That's kind of blank. I'm still missing one element here. Academic hierarchies are built on a notion of a learning curve, a gradual accumulation of knowledge over time. My graduate seminars have, for the past decade, rather become decolonial collaborations that seek to identify how white elite Euro-American men became arbiters of what counts as knowledge, thus defining what is deemed non-knowledge, ignorance, irrationality. In dialogues with graduate students, my unlearning curve grows steeper all the time. Now, the increased intensity of demands to challenge how whiteness and racism structure the academy that followed the death of George Floyd revealed the tremendous stakes for challenging racist hierarchies of knowledge. These conversations demanded deeper reflection on the limits imposed on my own white, male, elite, straight, able-bodied privilege. Now, unlearning. The book is a set of reflections and experiments. I took the undisciplining and unlearning process that I had previously undertaken in fragmented ways and kind of put it right out there, front and center. I also thought it was time to thank more adequately my mentors, including several whose teaching I received as a child growing up in semi-rural New Mexico. This goal, the latter one, however, almost killed the project. I had written all the chapters and I'd woven them together with the themes of mentorship and unlearning, but I couldn't force myself to write the introduction for 3 years. My editor was not happy with me. And then it occurred to me that I had unthinkingly slid into an academic scholarly rut. Introductions revolve around academic genealogies, placing what are supposed to be new ideas in trajectories provided by other scholars. Well, this fundamental contradiction, right? Celebrating mentors who themselves are positioned outside the academy to produce, and then starting that with an academic genealogy, would have undermined everything I was trying to accomplish in the book. And so it produced this massive resistance. And then I realized I could turn the introduction into a memoir that recounted my experiences with my mentors. At that point, writing the introduction was a blast. I would thus urge graduate students to take risks along these lines, even when their advisors may urge, shall we say, otherwise. When you're faced with a writer's block, maybe the problem isn't with you, but it's with the academic genres that you have been given. Maybe you could think about possibly experimenting at that moment. Now, In closing, I want to make sure that you don't think these reflections on my past work suggest that I'm done. I'm actually writing a kind of wild and wacky book on language and healing, and I'm engaged in this really large study of how the COVID-19 pandemic is affecting lives and work and relations. So I want to say that my process of unlearning and rethinking and getting assigned new challenges is really only just getting going. And with those brief words, it is a tremendous pleasure to be able to hand over the microphone to one of my most esteemed colleagues and best friends, Patricia Baquedano López.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is a real honor to comment on your work, Charles, my esteemed colleague, a generous human being, an intellectual guiding light across so many disciplinary fields and sites. I also thank the Center for Latin American Studies and Director Professora Natalia Brizuela for the kind invitation to join you all today. Thank you, Julia Bird, Associate Director, for the introduction. A formal greeting and hello to Dr. Bernardo Moreno Peniche. I'm taking the liberty in my comments of not following a linear account of the book, but rather I move back and forth among chapters and sections. I also move in some strange Charles Persian genre between I, you, and a third person Charles. This book of 10 chapters has been written and must be read as a manuscript of the interstitios, the interstices, the in-between, in the ever-productive liminal space that Gloria and Saldúa asked us to think about, and of other border thinkers, such as Walter Mignolo, cited abundantly in this work, particularly in chapter 4, The Coloniality of Folkloristics. They have exhorted us to consider as a possibility the borderlands for enduring the contradictions, the harm, the pain, the hopes, the revolution in response to the expansion and the forced and continued domination of Europe, the United States, onto the world. The book invites a contrapuntal reading to invoke Said and to interpret the texts that are presented, to examine them in simultaneous fashion, from authors advancing the violent impulse to modernity that colonized the world, to researchers of language and folklore in a now, and thanks to your work now recognized more as traditionality slash modernity, to the voices from your mentors and elders in New Mexico, Charles, and the laments of the wise women of the Delta Amacuro. Unlearning is a complex reading of texts that juxtaposes the power of the empire and of resistance to the empire. It is a book of retracings, but above all, it is a book that charts paths ahead. The liminal, contradictory spaces created and reflected in the book also outline the many paths of your own lived experience as you were describing. Thank you for sharing those. First, as you narrate your own life in the introduction, a trajectory growing up in New Mexico as an inquisitive and gentle kid who sought the company of older folks. It is easy to imagine you sitting on a porch practicing asking questions with old man Hawkins, a man tortured by gossip and lies, whose main reason for carrying a rifle, as you found out, but perhaps there were other reasons, and who doesn't enjoy a bit of notoriety, right? Was to protect his crops from birds. Charles later worked in Cordoba as a young anthropologist talking on apprenticing with elder Latinx wood carvers, was also interstitial, located between languages, races, ages, and trades. And after being invited to document the experiences of wood carvers for, you know, part of his university work, which I add in parentheses with the certainty of research methods, was, but what a surprise, Charles was refused an interview by the same elders. which sent him right back into the liminal, the space of contradiction, of ambiguity and possibility. Only San Isidro would later come to your rescue, the patron saint of laborers, who the elders and Charles memorialized in wood carvings. San Isidro Labrador, quita el agua y pon el sol. My indigenous grandmother asked us to chant as kids when the rain was about to destroy the grooves for planting in our plot of land back in Yucatan. San Isidro, Saint Isidore, keeps the rhythms of days, seasons, life, and it has kept Charles's calendar too, as new books harvest regularly. So let me pick up again that thread. The divine intervention of San Isidro on Charles's research and life opened up another realm of communicability among the human, post-human, non-human, land/human relationships, sun, water, plowing, harvesting, embodied and intextualized in the tactilities and discourses around carving the statue of a saint, a spiritual icon, and life in Cordoba. This is a relationship that would become even more central and guiding starting in the later chapters of the book, chapter 10, from progressive extractivism to phytosocialism, where a discussion on phytocommunicabilities, I hope that's pronounced that way, or the ways that plants, humans and other species produce and exchange knowledge, materialities, notions expanded in Charles's book to include the interrelatedness and intimacy that shapes plant-human experience in Cordoba, mediated by wood carvings between people, land, and the spiritual domain in ways that also subverted colonialism and Christianity. In the Delta, this interrelated domain was mediated by plants, animals, viruses, people, and the government. To return to the failed interviewed attempt, the refusal of the interview is the subject of Charles's writing and of grounding an incredible book, Learning How to Ask, that would provide a foundational document and guide for folklorists, anthropologists, and really a wide range of researchers. I know for sure in education and social work and public health on the inevitability of blunders because we don't belong, and the importance of metacommunicative skills, but perhaps less skill, more sensitivity, more disposition, more relationality. Though that work complements another work of one of your elders, Américo Paredes's essay on ethnographic work among minority groups, a folkloristic perspective, that begged us to have a keener sense of performance, to learn to separate the dancer from the dance, but perhaps to question if that is even possible. And Paredes also engaged contrapuntal interpretations in the ballad of Gregorio Cortez, as you noted and you talk about, but also in other writings like Washington Gomez and the tragic character of the Mexican-American borderlands of Texas, Gualinto, destined to become a great man, but he had learned to doubt the resistant movement as an important read in his article, in Paredes' article, Border Literary Histories, Globalization, and Critical Regionalism. Sorry, I'm misreading. This is José Limón's critique, right? An analysis of Paredes' Gualinto. In chapter 3 of Unlearning, What We Should Have Learned from Américo Paredes, Charles calls it as it is. We would be experiencing a very different sense of positioning of the field and the society, but Paredes was shunned, racialized, dismissed. And you know, this, we would have had a very different sense of position in society. I'd love to follow up on this in our discussion later on. But Charles also explains Paredes's bringing about agency to otherwise flat characters. Paredes humanized and decolonized our perceptions. So the work in Venezuela I'm about to finish soon cements, from my point of view, the theoretical model around ideologies of communication of communicability, the central subject of part three of the book, A New Poetics of Health, Multi-Species Relations and Environments. These ideologies mobilize practices that produce certain types of subjectivities and do their own interpolation of and colonial work so that people inhabit these subjectivities, which are, after all, modern subjectivities that position indigenous bodies in particular ways. And here, I think it could be helpful to invoke the work of Jody Bird. As indigenous bodies are made to transit, they are transit of the empire, where colonial knowledge is deposited, managed, and regulated. Communicability is part of this transit and immobilization, as it also racializes, medicalizes in rather violent ways, as your work, you know, bringing the epidemics to public light illustrates. Not want to do much charting of Charles's life trajectory parallel to the development of the book, but that is an invitation to the reader. But I only mention one more period, and that is the process of becoming a healer. And one can be more liminal again than this transition, this initiation and passage here in Victor Turner's sense. This puts you right into the middle of two pandemics. Again, in the interstices of death and life, two liminal experiences that produce the only possibility for this work's title and content, the necessity for deep unlearning in the form of an urgent call that moves into genres of exegesis, interpretation, lament, and a plea. But in that totality, I actually think that your book is an academic grito. Ya que mencionaste a Freud and dedicated him an epistolary chapter six in Rethinking Psychoanalysis, Poetics and Performance, I think this grito is not so much a sense of a grito demanding an other, a listener for the benefit of the ego, but a grito that is an action and effect. More an invitation to abolish, because this book abolishes, and an invitation to liberation. Well, perhaps that grito part, is the deeply Mexican in me. Let me see, I'm just trying to not spend much more time here. I also wanna, you know, invite as we read and talk more about your writing, the thorough and at times quite demanding attention to references, actors, and ideas of different epochs. Thank you for that. A thinker starting in the pre-Enlightenment period, for example, your attention to John Locke's rationality, ways to think about language, inviting us to think of ways to think about language away from true meanings of language to, you know, discoveries, forgive me for using that word, but it's relevant, of multiplicity and ways of speaking in the dangers of traditionalization and modernity. You invite us to think about genealogies, and at times you lead us to critically question genealogies, as you noted in your introduction. You take us through Herder's excitement for the social, the emotional, the love for history, to the opportunistic Grimm brothers, the beginning of folklore, and we're then asked out of breath, as we already are, to come to a screeching stop and face Boas and his documentation project of dying cultures, languages, and stories, right? So we experience again the construction of folklore and folkloristics. I think about Bernard Perley's work in zombie linguistics, so close to a critique to Boas's work. Linguistics of dead, dormant, and dying languages, which actually means dead, dormant, and dying people. And, you know, an insistence about erasure of the native as a way to claim, again, indigenous as property. So let me end with one commentary. It seemed to me that the motif resonated against today's fast tempo of an uncontrollable mutating COVID-19 virus, the slowness of lockdowns, the erratic intervention of our unforgivable injustice, distributing vaccine and booster shots. Your book, in the earlier book with Clara Mantini-Briggs, reminds us that labor invested in producing, countering, and circulating knowledge can save lives. You showed us how much ethical commitment as researchers, medics, academics could have saved lives for many families in the Delta and elsewhere in the world. You end your book with a lament and a plea, which I have turned into a grito. I read from your final paragraph. You say, "The efforts that I have undertaken in the preceding pages to disrupt business as usual practices, scholarly and engaged, have suddenly been folded into the emerging landscape of a world on edge. In this book, I have tried to perform a poetics that goes beyond liberal calls to listen to marginal voices, which can constitute forms of appropriation that use humanistic camouflage to protect the status quo." Whoa. "My goal has rather been to outline a practice for finding a more diverse set of mentors, learning to listen to each and joining dialogues capable of dismantling our most basic assumption, crafting alternatives and helping turn them into lived realities. The stakes are high and the challenges are calling each and every one of us." I'm listening, Charles. I too have an unlearning curve to travel. And I thank you for the opportunity to think and learn from you. And I thank everyone here today.
I guess it's my turn to talk about this book. Thank you, Dr. Baquedano Lopez, for these words. And also thank you, Charles, for inviting me to first read your book and be part of this group. I'm learning and unlearning a lot already. Thank you as well, the Center of Latin American Studies, for inviting me to participate. I think it would be wrong to say that Charles Briggs is the only author of this book. More than a monologue, what he offers in these pages is a dialogue, but it is a particular kind of dialogue. He brings us on board right from the beginning to share polyphonic space with peaches, 17th century British scholars, mango trees, mythical creatures, academics, childhood friends, rainforest dwellers, wooden saints, and many more to discuss, not without discomfort, about the politics of knowledge, language, and health. What stands out here is that all these conversations are in fact deeply theoretical, but theory here does not spring up from the mouths or minds of academics or scholars, but from wood carving, myth telling, healing, house building, and importantly, mourning. This is not a book about high theory, but about theory that matters, literally as material. The material engagements of multiple things and beings as they act, perform, and speak for what they care about. To invoke Maria Puig de la Vela Casa's words, here, care is mobilized to serve a gathering purpose, to hold together a thing and the publics concerned, end quote. I believe this holding together is part of the work of unlearning that Briggs is inviting us to engage with. For my part, as a physician who's trying to learn from anthropology sensitivities to human life, unlearning has taken up most of my space for academic engagement. To borrow Michelle Murphy's phrasing, how to think and work with and against biomedicine, how to hold together in conversation such divergent positions. Charles Briggs' book gives us valuable insights into how this can be done in a way that does not take boundaries for granted, but that moves across them at the same time that one works to understand how they are built and, if necessary, how to dismantle them. While there is so much to reflect on and say about this book, I will focus my comments on one aspect that occupies my thoughts because it is in close relation to my research interests. Notions of traditionality and modernity in public health and epidemic control demand us to unlearn that these two, this is traditionality and modernity, are not necessarily opposing extremes. The boundary between them is not always clearly drawn. Responding to Walter Mignolo's notion of the interimplications of modernity and coloniality, Charles draws attention to how traditionality is in itself a modern object, and as such, it constitutes a central resource of colonial domination. In other words, traditionality and modernity are two sides of the same coin, a coin named coloniality. I thus extend the exploration of this trinity of power, coloniality, modernity, traditionality, to how it plays in the context of the so-called emerging infectious diseases. The category of emerging infectious diseases obeys to concerns about biosecurity. A pathogen is considered emergent when it threatens a new population or if its incidence increases rapidly outside its usual traditional geographic range. In the particular disease I work with, Chagas disease, non-traditional transmission of the etiological agent, the parasite Trypanosoma cruzi, are those that occur not among impoverished immigrants coming from the US, from Latin American countries, but among hikers, hunters, or rural homestead owners in the US. In other words, humans hailing from south of the US borders who live in rural areas in close intimacy with animals identified as reservoirs are the traditional and therefore naturalized subjects of disease. The non-traditional cases, those that raise the epidemiological alarm, refer to when the modern subject, mainly white, wealthier men, become infected. Here we see also another iteration of the traditionality, modernity, coloniality triad in health, which organizes health politics across geographies and human and non-human bodies. As Celia Lowe mentions in her work on viral clouds, the fact that upon the emergence and rapid propagation of avian influenza in Indonesia in 2003, what had been valorized in the United States as free-range chicken, a multi-species practice on the borderline of traditionality and modernity, was transformed through avian flu preparedness campaigns into an agricultural method that threatened the world with a pandemic. In associating backyard poultry production with traditional Asian agricultural practices, in contrast to modern commercial poultry production, Asian culture itself became viewed by global health commentators as a potent source of risk. In this case, more than just standing in clear opposition, modernity and traditionality find confluence in coloniality through medicalization, which in turn pathologized certain human and non-human interaction in the service of coloniality. In a more recent instance of pathologization of tradition from a modernizing perspective, we can bring forth the ongoing claims to shut down the so-called wet markets in China and other southern countries, Latin America included, as well as the infamous demoting through jokes of the almost now proverbial bat soup. Here, race, species, coloniality were put in the same way of modernization at the expense of traditionality. Yet, it is problematic when the critique of the pathologization of tradition follows, as Charles suggests, quote, romantic notions of the nature of indigenous and other subaltern identities that underlie some work in both postcolonial and decolonial studies, end quote. Doing so, this siding up with tradition as a morally superior position against modernity and coloniality may entail not only falling for what Tuck and Yang call the settler's move to innocence, but failing to engage with the complexities of what Briggs has called traditionalization. According to Charles, traditionalization constitutes, quote, a process through which a broad range of cultural forms are constructed so as to link them to the emergence of similar forms in the past, end quote. Such orientation to the past can saturate cultural forms with affects and patterns of expectation that structure how audiences engage with them, end quote. As such, and responding to how different publics gather around things they care about, it can be said that traditionalization processes can be both profoundly depoliticizing and capable of repoliticizing cultural forms. So getting back to the emerging infectious diseases, these diseases do not occur without important narrative and discursive dimensions that not only organize how epidemics develop in different communities, but also how preventative and control measures are designed and deployed. As Charles shows in chapter 9, Germ Warfare, when emerging infectious diseases become epidemic and potentially pandemic, their propagation as a biosocial event does not go without the long-standing mediatization of outbreak narratives that manufacture an already traditionalized epidemic spacetime, or what Bakhtin would call chronotope. Characterized by dramatic movements between types of spaces, actors, and types of narrative authority, as well as an emphasized temporal construction of the virus as new. In Charles' words, newness brings a distinct temporalization practices of journalism, virology, epidemiology, public health, and clinical medicine into alignment, turning the new pandemic disease into a boundary object that fosters translatability and sparks shared concern, end quote. Traditionalization of outbreak narratives, where stories about new modern objects travel back and forth from fiction to science, from journalism to government reports, evinces how narratives, quote, do not simply report, but make events. In other words, there is a dialogic constitution of epidemic emergence at the intersection of genres, spaces, and actors, some of them non-human, that clash against each other to perform anxiety as an overarching affect. So studying epidemics then requires paying attention not only to pathogenic transmission, but moreover to the complex relations between the circulation of pathogens and discourse. In short, what Charles calls biocommunicability. As we know well by now, epidemics are much more than massive pathogenic infection and transmission. A job that we, anthropologists, social scientists, and scholars of the humanities can take up on this regard is holding together the stories, narratives, and concerns that circulate and constitute epidemics as nature cultural events, and to work with biomedicine to find better ways to fare during these epidemics, even as we challenge monopolizing attempts to theorize epidemics in ways that aim to secure colonial orders. What follows now is, I'm gonna ask if Dr. Baquedano López has any questions, either for Charles or for myself. And also if Charles has any questions for any of us too.
Thank you, Bernardo. I think that we've gotten there's a lot of material that we can unpack and begin to talk about. I have a comment, and it's a question embedded in a comment. And the one of the responses and reactions that I had to the book, and I've been having to the work, having gone and look at some of the material that you have been writing for a while, Charles, I have been asking myself the space of, and this is asking you, me, to think together about something a little bit beyond the book, but certainly inspired by it. In anthropology, in the work of language, we have been concerned with huge, bigger questions of concern around adults, around our categories of older people. And I am looking in the book, especially as an anthropologist in education, what is the space, what is the intellectual space for children, they are the subject of the work in Venezuela for sure. The question that you ask, that the mothers ask, tell me why my children died, you know, like that is, you know, bringing the experience, the bodies of children into a conversation. But I wonder if there is, you know, do we have a space in the work that we're doing in you know, linguistic anthropology, you know, for children to be actors in this experiences of communicability as you write about. You know, I know there's work on translation and children as brokers who do the kind of, you know, the work that you're talking about. But I wonder if there is another space. Maybe we need to rethink the category of children, of childhood. So it's just a question to selfish a question because it is my field, but I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on, is there a space in the work that you're doing for helping us think and rethink children as actors or childhood in this work?
Well, first of all, thank you so much to both of you. I mean, that was such deep and wonderful readings of the book, generous, and also with lots of things that really sort of, that I need to think about a lot. I mean, writing a book is often, in some ways, it's something which forces us, unfortunately, most of the time in the social sciences, humanities, unlike the sciences, into a kind of an individual corner. I mean, even before pandemics, right? And it's amazing to be able to have, unfortunately, these conversations ordinarily happen after you publish a book. It would be so nice to be able to actually have these kind of conversations that go into making the book. I've co-authored books with Claudia Montini Briggs and then also with Richard Bauman, where sometimes those conversations and coming from different points of view are very much part of the making of the book. And there's so many things to pick up on here, but let me start with children. One thing I'm actually now in this crazy book I'm writing now, really thinking about, you know, what happened with Locke, who was a doctor, right? And who actually sort of said, understanding language means and understanding politics must be entirely divorced from the body, right? Even though most of his time was focused on his own ailing body, right? He had a respiratory disease, right? Mm-hmm. All of that time. And that's partly why he wrote so much, because, you know, he had a lot of time when he was laid up. So it's interesting to think about. Now, the standard subject, the only person who, you know, remember, knowledge is disembodied, language is disembodied. And you have to pretend as if you aren't attached to a particular identity or address or body to be able to speak in modern terms according to Locke. But of course, the only people who really could fit into that slot were elite European male able-bodied adults. And he specifically pathologized childhood, mm-hmm, as something which rendered people incapable of being able to have that sort of conscious, reflective understanding of language. So it wasn't just, you know, laborers. It wasn't just class and race and gender. I mean, women, because of course, women were concerned with childbirth in his terms. So he disqualified everybody else. So the only bodies who got connected to modernity were people very much like him, except that, of course, he had a disabled body, which is actually fascinating if you look at his letters and his biography. But somehow that gets entirely unwritten in what becomes the modern account of communication. So fascinating. I think in terms of your question about how bodies get tied together in pandemic times. And that's certainly something I'm really finding now with all of the interviews I'm doing with so many people in tracing what's happened, how the pandemic is woven into the fine fabric of people's lives, how there is no pandemic, but only as many pandemics in terms of the experience as there are people. But thinking about in the middle of the rabies pandemic, where there's a woman who had lost two children and she's recounting the dying words of her 8-year-old son, right, in a canoe, trying to get medical help for him. And again, no one knew that it was rabies, and this was a pretty much 100% fatal disease. And as the child is dying, she says, I'm going now. My cousin who previously died is coming for me. I'm leaving you, mother. And she says, don't go, stay with me. And so my son said, okay, mother, I won't leave. I will stay here and I will comfort you. I'll be with you. My body will grow cold, but I will not leave you. And here, as she's narrating, she inscribes her symptoms that was actually in that last slide there on her own legs. So where's the adult? Where's the child? Where's the body of the narrator? The body of the mother? The body of this particular child? And where is this strange pathogen that transforms an eight-year-old child's nervous system in such a way that he becomes an incredibly mature individual who provides his mother with, who can foresee her grief and provide her with the words that she will sing in her own lament. So, I mean, it's amazing to think about in these sorts of situations, whether it's rabies or cholera or now COVID-19, our fundamental understandings of who we are and what we are really get overturned, right? Think about long COVID, where in ways in which physicians are really, I think, Dr. Bernardo can tell me if I'm wrong, really at a loss to fully understand what's going on with these broad range of symptoms where so many bodies are becoming, for medium term or long term, seriously disabled. So what is happening to bodies, to understandings of self, to understandings of work? What is the great movement away from medicine and all as people resign, the great resignation? So wonderful question, wonderful. But you know, I don't want to run out of time. We have, I think, lots of people there. I feel as if I certainly have talked too much already. I would love to hear what the questions are, and then maybe the two of you respond to them. Unless Bernardo would like to jump in here at this point.
I mean, I do have a question, but I would like to read this question from the audience first. Can we speak to this, the centering of the scholarly ethos in academia and what this imply?
Would one of the two of you like to respond to that first?
It's rich. It's a good question. I think the book is offering us a way to understand and enter, you know, question. Is that the question to question the ethos of academia?
Right? Yeah, can we speak to this, the centering of the scholarly ethos in academia and what this implies?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the reading of the book gives us, so one of the exciting parts about the book in general is the, you know, I don't know how many chapters have at the end of the book, you know, and this is so hard to write, guidelines, possibilities of what to do with the content of the particular chapters. But I really love the way that there are, imagination to change the academy. I think that this is at the end of the chapters, these discussions, what they do bring is a possibility of challenging the university in particular, right? Challenging genealogies we've been talking about that. Bernardo, you mentioned the challenge of genealogies earlier on, and Charles, you did too. And that is at the core of changing the ethos of the academy, right? And the invitation in the book to work with mentors that are not the genealogical typical in the academy is indeed a way to change the course of the academy, right? To have a different location of knowledge, inform and change the way we do the work of the academy. What do you think, Bernardo?
I was looking for a quote that I had here about this, but yeah, So I think that part of this, I mean, this is of course like a very, like a huge work, and also might be a huge answer, but also part of what Charles asks to unlearn in this book is who makes theory, and what is our job as academics. So citing Margaret Mills, she says, "Our data, anecdotes, gossip, incidents where we were present are always already speaking theory, somebody's theory, theory in the everyday. And it's our job to sort out whose theory is this." So I think that part of this, the answer that your question makes me think about is really acknowledging what, who's the owner of the work that we, which we, with which we engage. Yeah.
Well, just a couple words, because I'd rather hear another question, but it's, I just finished my term as the president of the Society for Medical Anthropology. And one thing that we're really concerned with is, you know, the way in which people who are not deemed scholars, but practitioners themselves are entirely marginalized, right, within this profession. I mean, people who are like, you know, leaders at the CDC, or people who are out there activists in the street. And now one thing that we're really facing is thinking about the future of so many people who either, on the one hand, want to have careers that involve scholarly tools, but want to be in the world as well. Maybe want to bridge things that are in the academy and things that are in activism or within fields of practice, right? And how much the deck is really stacked against, on the one hand, people being able to do that, right? To be in some sense discounted once they're seen as no longer within the scholarly domain. And thinking a lot about students now who themselves are facing all of the change, the neoliberalization of the market for academics, and at the same time, the labor market for all sorts of other professions. A second thing is also, I mean, you kept drawing us back to Paredes, who really is my norte, my North Star in so many ways, who himself was a singer, a performer, a journalist, a novelist, a poet, and an amazing scholar. If he's part of, was he part of the scholarly ethos? Right? As you noted, if people had listened to him in 1958, scholarship would be different. He challenged anthropology's construction of the other long before Clifford and Marcus really began work on writing culture. So if he was part of that scholarly ethos, who was also sitting there and saying, listen to the voices of people who are on the border, who have been challenging through song and through every other modality, racism, right? And white hegemony, right? What things, where we might have been, and I love the way in which you bring us back to there. So this is a crucial question. So whose scholarly ethos? How do we even think about those, that form of scholarly ethos? How do we decenter that? And at the same time, find out really how it is that, that scholarship itself is tremendously constrained, deadened, by its failure to have an active dialogue with people who fashion themselves often as not being scholars, but somehow become producers of data. How is it that one can potentially decenter that? But also, to tell you the truth, I'd probably look at, again, those conversations with graduate students who are going to be probably much better at really responding to that question than I would be.
Well, thank you, Charles. Dr. Baquedano Lopez, we have another question here in the chat. It says, Ethnic Studies 103, Deconstructing Race-Based Medicine and Health Inequities, is watching this talk. And since we will be talking on the racial and gender aspects of COVID later in the semester, what do you think is the connection between coloniality and the racial gender inequities in pandemic health that you are seeing through your interviews? I believe this goes directly to Charles.
Wow. First of all, I'd love to listen in on the class. And I think that's really, really important. I taught in at the university at UCSD in the Department of Ethnic Studies for a decade. And I was able to get classes going there that really looked at health, which had not been a particular topic within race and ethnic studies in the department, and also language. And this is so important. And there's such amazing scholarship now, which is in between ethnic studies, race and ethnic studies, history, anthropology, other areas that really begins to think about these sorts of issues. I think partly when I was interviewing, working with folks who were in this area of Venezuela, where 500 people had died from cholera, which is a bacterial infection, which essentially should kill no one. What you need is clean water, essentially. And also access, if you get sick, to simple, simple forms of therapy. And so, you know, you do epidemiology and you say, you know, we went through every one of the communities in this vast area and asked people, when did the epidemic begin? And so my favorite quote was when someone said, in 1498, 1498 is when Columbus got lost and landed right there on the South American mainland. So for them, colonialism was the beginning of these epidemics. And they really traced the racialization of life, right, to that particular point. Now, it's amazing in the interviews I've done. I spent a week in the San Joaquin Valley, which people often call the Central Valley, which at this point seems to be in the global race for the bottom, that is in terms of worker rights and living conditions, seems to be right up there with other nations in terms of really coming in last place. And thinking about how food scarcity and really oppressive conditions that leave bodies just worn out, often by the age of 40, right, in the fields or in the packing plants. And then along comes the pandemic, right, and where there is almost no personal protective equipment provided, and where people are often required to come to work sick, right? To come to work sick. And on top of all of those forms of oppression, which we know all there are actually the epidemiological statistics showing, as we all know, that Latinx, Black, and Native American populations were hit particularly hard because, guess what? Nothing new, because that is an ongoing colonial history of health inequities, right? So here in these interviews, it's amazing to think about people who are connecting some of those dots. I would say it's amazing that some of the journalists that I've said who would once in a while do a story on health and race, right, said now you cannot not think about racial inequities in any story that you write. So it's really quite interesting in some ways that the pandemic has forced people to connect some of those dots. On the other hand, unfortunately, it's kind of like the woodcarvers. Almost all that you see is about Latinx population, about essential workers, right? Maybe we'll get a few of their quotes there. We get a few people who stand in as the figures. Where are the policymakers asking, right? The people who are in the front lines most affected by the pandemic, for the ideas, because frankly, we're lost in terms of health communication, in terms of health policy, and in so many areas, in terms of making the connections that need to be made, right? But somehow there seems to be now in pandemics, there is this transfer of knowledge that scientists know, and the rest of us need to be listening passively. Well, guess what? It didn't work for about half the population, right, which is entirely tuned out scientists and doctors, or not quite, but a lot. And now even folks who believe in vaccination, right, and masking themselves, often these forms of health communication are in some ways becoming more and more problematic. So that's a really wonderful question. Thinking about people in these interviews who say, now, how is it that the pandemic gets woven into the daily texture of racialized life in the San Joaquin Valley, or in for Berkeley students. We did a wonderful group in the spring semester a year ago with Berkeley students who really were themselves the Berkeley Latinx pandemic autoethnography collective, thinking about their own lives and how the pandemic had been woven into the tiny details of how they try to stay online, stay, have enough to be able to continue to live as their jobs often ended. So it's a wonderful, wonderful question. And fortunately now there is so much research that's being done that richly documents the effects, how it is that the fatal ways that racialization and medicine come together. But we also want to think about, for example, work on the Black Panthers, right? Of knowing that back in the 70s, the Panthers were challenging racism, including in terms of its effect on health communication and healthcare delivery. So the social movements who themselves, particularly in the 70s, had health at the top of their agendas. You know, Cesar Chavez, health, right? Rights and health. Ways in which people connected in South Texas, voting rights and healthcare, right? Which of course, classically anthropologists kind of missed both of those back at the time. So anyway, wonderful question, sounds great. I really applaud your students for being here and engaging in the dialogue. And I can't wait to hear what comes out of it.
Okay, we don't have any more questions at the moment. Okay. I mean, I have a very small question on, it's a completely different topic, but I would like to hear more about, and you did said it like in passing, what's the relationship between the woodcarvers in Cordoba, New Mexico, and also the canoe carvers in Delta Macuro, given that both are, in a certain way, I mean, they're very, very different objects, for sure, but I would like to hear more about what, if you find some connections,
That's a great, great question. So in Cordoba, you had people who took aspen wood and used that to carve figures of the saints and of birds and trees. And mostly at the time, early on, they were bought by gringos, by white middle-class people who saw them as small, as basically evidence of the sort of quaint traditional character of the people who carved them. The people who carved them said, I don't want to work as a janitor in Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory sweeping up after the people who are making bombs. I want to stay in my own community. And this is a way I can do it, right? And so for them, often this was a response to land and labor expropriation and racism, right? Now, it's fascinating because what I learned was at first, I mean, the great thing that Patricia was talking about was, how do you make knowledge? So I was taught, I mean, I was 19. I was so stupid. I mean, I was just beginning, but I learned that you interview people and you have a list of questions. So I sat down and asked the woodcarvers who wanted me to sort of write a book about them, you know, some simple questions about woodcarving. And they, you know, George Lopez, who saw in the photograph, you know, listened to my first question. He went, boss, quién sabe, who knows, right? My whole world, my career crushed. It died before it even began. So I went to the second question and I got the same answer. And what was amazing there was saying, you're not going to get at this through your own sort of constructing an artificial context through which you draw me in as a basically a someone who is on the lower end of the power spectrum, right? When you know nothing about the topic, first of all, you begin. So he said, so it collapsed. I sat there in their kitchen for a week. Finally, he handed me a piece of wood and a penknife and didn't say anything, but figured I might be smart enough, despite all evidence to the contrary, to know to begin carving. So I had to develop a relationship to the wood and understand how it was that the materiality, another species, right? And the process of engaging with that wood and with the imagination, as Patricia so nicely said, with San Isidro Labrador, right? Emerged through that relationship. Now, there, there was no sense that it was a sense that the wood was alive and really was part of, first of all, the land and reclaiming the land. This was part of the lands that had been claimed by the Forest Service. So the ability of going back on the land and being able to take that wood as part of a process of reappropriation of the landscape and of ways of interacting with the landscape. Now, what's fascinating there was, here you have the ways in which there was an embodied relationship in the body, forms of knowledge of saints and so forth, ideas about the past, other species and materiality. Now, in Venezuela, to carve a canoe is not sort of particularly just an artisanal sort of operation. It involves an interaction with Daurani, with the mud, with the mother of the forest, right? With a mythological creature. Now, mythology means talking about a world that's present and powerful and coexistent, but hard to see, and comes alive either through myths or through the making of a canoe. So the making of a canoe required a negotiation with Daurani, where actually, of course, it's sexualized, as a lot of things are there, where the carver becomes a sort of suitor who has to be able to approach and court a tree that could be made through an act of violence of cutting it down and carving it into a canoe. So here you have, first of all, multi-species relations. This is not lost on you, who is actually at this point really developing a wonderful dissertation that thinks about these multi-species relations in different sorts of ways, where you have, you know, all sorts of, including bugs in there, but ways in which also in terms of thinking about dimensions, right, of the body. The canoe is the body of the tree, which is the body of the mother of the forest, and how therefore somehow that process of carving it out becomes a relationship between multiple bodies, some of which are unseen, which is also therefore potentially connected here to, on the one hand, healing the land and healing people from racism in New Mexico, right? And healing also the processes of people who were then, you know, faced with cholera, tuberculosis, malaria, beyond all sorts of diseases in Delta Macuro, with this very delicate balance between bodies of nature, and thinking about how it is that these particular sorts of relations are created and upset. Now, mind you, the planet's dying, folks, in case you haven't noticed. And at this point, it seems that remarkably little is being done to think about how we could creatively intervene into this process. And here you have folks on a daily basis who are thinking about and enacting those sorts of relations and trying to carve out, so to speak, new futures. So that's, I guess, what I would say is both of these are carving, you know, out futures that involve interactions with landscape that have been faced, that have been focused by racism and by colonialism, right, for hundreds of years. And how is it that we come to be able to listen? How is it that some topic like writing about wood carving or writing about making canoes themselves can potentially become ways in which we can listen to folks who are thinking imaginatively about the potential for new futures for which we're often ourselves not deaf? And by the way, as we think about this now relationship between the mistrust or the rejection of expert knowledge and of science and of medicine, and then the stereotyping of people who are seen as being anti-vaxxers or anti-maskers, right? Creating powerful, problematic sorts of boundaries that even unfold within families and workspaces, right? How is it that potentially we could think about a lot of folks who are thinking beyond, who have forms of knowledge themselves that are not themselves framed as expert knowledge that could potentially produce so many insights? And how is it that we can get into a conversation, not just to somehow bring in these other forms of knowledge, that's traditional sort of approachative formulation, but to really help us unthink how we got into this amazing problematic of not just a dying planet, but the fact that we really cannot ourselves find ways of healing social relations, much less social communities vis-a-vis the pandemic, and the ways in which policies themselves are placing into basic infrastructures here forms of increased inequity that no vaccine will ever heal, including at Berkeley, with respect to educational inequities themselves that were enhanced by the pandemic. So how is it that we could potentially, that's a wonderful question, how is it that we could listen to such small things, right, as carving, right, an image or carving a canoe as being potentially ways in which we could find our own role in crafting new futures. And frankly, I think what we all have to do is find where is that wood carving in our own lives, in our own relations. Who are the people who have those modalities, those ways, those insights? Who are our mentors, right? And by the way, if some of your mentors are academics, that's okay too. In the book, I talk about some of those, right? But on the other hand, who are those people in our lives, in our communities, who have those forms of knowledge, which again, we could put together with medicine, with really the practice of education, the school of education, with all of our own theoretical knowledge in different sorts of dialogic relationships that might begin to get us a little closer to a more just, equitable, and healthy world.
Well, what a stirring call to end on. This conversation has stirred a lot in for me, and I can see that there are a couple more questions that are coming in, and I'm sorry we don't have time for all of them, but Professor Briggs, we will email them to you and we can talk about if it makes sense for you to take more time out of your busy schedule to respond to them. I want to give a big thank you to Professor Briggs, Professor Baquedano Lopez, and Dr. Moreno Peninche. And I also want to wish a very happy birthday to Bernardo. I heard it's your birthday today. So thank you for taking time on your birthday to celebrate in this way. And I hope you now can go eat some cake. Thank you to everyone and have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Feliz
cumpleaños. Thank you. Gracias. Bye.